So the first question, basically this is about machine life. Personally, I have this belief that, you know, if you look at the grand cosmos, there's this grand scheme, grand origins story that you can talk from a naturalistic viewpoint, from an atheist viewpoint, that, you know, from the Big Bang, we had, basically there was not anything material existing. From that, we had matter, and then from matter arose biological life. And I think going forward, we're going to see a machine life, a machine sentience, an awareness, which is different than our awareness and is actually superior. And so I think we're starting to see some of the fruit of that already about machine life. And so recently, just in the last week or so, there was an article about driverless cars, and it was saying that the Google car basically is a self-driving car, and it's self-driving to the extent that even there is no steering wheel. So basically the driver, so-called driver of this car, is really just a passenger. There is no driver of the car other than the Google operating system. And so Google petitioned to get the car recognized as a driver, and the transportation department agreed with Google that yes, the car is a driver, and that the person who owns the car is basically just a passenger. So I think this is going to be an interesting thing going forward, where if there's a car accident, can they actually sue Google and basically treating the car as a person? And so just to give some more background information on this, is that we know just in general, computers have been getting closer and closer to intelligence, human intelligence. So for example, Deep Blue is a computer that won at chess. So now the chess champion now is a computer. Watson was a computer. I believe both of these, Deep Blue and Watson, were developed at IBM. Watson beat at the game of Jeopardy. So now Jeopardy is where you have a trivia game. And so now the best player at Jeopardy is a computer. And now we have cars that drive so well, they do not let the humans drive. And this is the Google car. So what if you take all of these applications and roll them up into one? You know, maybe 20 years or 50 years from now, these are just apps in your smartphone. I mean, this kind of awareness, it just kind of shows where things are going. You know, and some people now have, there's this Siri program on Apple products where you can talk to Siri and say, like, Siri, what is the meaning of life? And it'll say, oh, that's easy, the meaning of life is, and it'll probably read something from Wikipedia or something, or a dictionary for a definition. But it's interesting that you could have a conversation with computers, and people are now developing relationships with computers. And it's like, if you didn't know that was a computer, you might actually think that was a person, because you can have a conversation with it. And people are going to come to the point where they can say, I swear that computer has got a soul, because it's got an attitude. It seems like it has its own mind. It's learning and talking with me. So Neil, can you see my point that computers are getting so advanced that, you know, if that computer doesn't have a soul, then why would you say a human has a soul? Because really, what's the difference? The computers are going to be self-learning and having attitudes and opinions. What's the difference?
Well, I see, I would agree with you. If by soul we mean the functioning of the mind, then absolutely. I mean, if we are just meat machines and the computer is a silicon machine with some, you know, some fiberglass thrown at PCB, then yeah, we are the same as a computer, and the computer could have a soul just as well. I don't believe that. I don't buy that. And there are fundamental problems when you go back into, and this comes back to the first of all, there are fundamental problems. Where did matter come from? Where did life come from? These are questions that science has been unable to answer, right? We have the best answer we have is it accidentally happened, and this is a nice theory, but there's no way to prove it. We can't say that this is exactly how. I mean, the abiogenesis has been disproved by Pasteur since the 18th century. So yet here we are again saying, yeah, abiogenesis is the reason why life exists, and then we're saying, well, why does matter exist? The Big Bang somewhere. Well, I believe the Big Bang was banged by a banger, right? So these are the differences. But let's go a step further, I think, because that, you know, we understand those differences.
I would have some difference of opinion on you, but I want to kind of, it seems like that's kind of going off topic. I mean, I want to bring it back you know, the computers.
So I want to come back. I mean, and we know that we disagree on those issues, right? So we both disagree on those issues. So we understand that. But let me explain why.
Well, I also disagree on your statement about abiogenesis, that it was disproven. But yeah, abiogenesis. Yeah. But we can talk about that later.
We can talk about that. I didn't mean to slip in a debatable issue there. we can definitely cover that if you wish. But what my point is, is that I think that if you were to take somebody's mind and you were to start cutting it up, right, at no point will you find the part of his mind that makes up who he is, right? That part does not exist. And so let me suggest something different, right? Let me suggest an alternative possibility. At the point of the Big Bang, and we've had this discussion before, the point of the Big Bang, we have calculated that there could be as easily up to 10 other dimensions. Four of them we know of, and that is height, length, breadth, and time. Those are the four dimensions. But there are six other possible dimensions that they've calculated are feasibly there, and the Large Hadron Collider was built so that they could send a particle into one of those dimensions. So this isn't all just science fiction. This is stuff that we are hopefully going to prove in the next few years. If there are other dimensions, then these would not be the natural dimensions. These would be the supernatural dimensions. And so, therefore, if there is an intersection, the mind and the body, just like you are a two-dimensional being, you have no comprehension of a three-dimensional being, yet I could not only be as close to you, if you're a two-dimensional being on a piece of paper and I touch you, I would be touching you. I could even be inside. You would not know that because you only understand those two dimensions, that I'm a three-dimensional being. So in the same way, if we are, let's say we have a fifth-dimensional mind or entity, and that is our soul, that intersects with our material, our meat machines, and works those meat machines. And maybe there's some sort of symbiotic or some sort of easily disengageable relationship between that fifth dimension and our four-dimensional beings that, when that is severed, something different, you know, the death of the body results in something with the soul and so on and so forth. I think this clearly can explain, scientifically, mind you, the relationship between the soul and the body.
Well, you said that could explain it, but you're just appealing to a mystery. I mean, we don't know how many dimensions there are and all that. I mean, some people might say when you bring up there could be all these dimensions and all these things we don't know, therefore it could explain this. I mean, you can say that about any mystery. It's like, how does this make sense? This doesn't make any sense because of A, B, and C. Well, you know, there may be other dimensions. That's how you could explain it.
Although I think it's limited. I think there's limited explanation power that you have because we're saying material things have material causes, but this is a supernatural cause. The soul part of it. Oh, okay, again, now, there's no way I can prove this to you. No. I agree 100% there's no way I can prove it to you because all it does is it provides explanatory power, right? Now, I do know that we do think that there are multiple dimensions, and I do know that when you start looking at these multiple dimensions, the intersection of these dimensions can explain spirits, can explain demons, can explain the angels. We do know that there has to be a extra natural dimension, that is something outside of the universe, because whatever created the universe was not inside the universe. So whatever caused the Big Bang had to be outside of time, outside of space, and outside of matter. Had to be not dependent on energy, because energy, time, and space all were created at the Big Bang. But, so whatever caused the Big Bang was extra-dimensional in that sense.
Okay, but again, you're saying these extra dimensions can explain things like demons and these you're basically appealing to another unknown again. You're appealing to unknown dimensions to explain an unknown.
Yes, it doesn't really explain anything. It does explain things, but the thing is that we have not yet been able to prove it. Now, once we get into the intersection of the multidimensional, when once the Large Hadron Collider is able to prove to us that there are other dimensions. And I actually think there are other dimensions. I think all the science points to it. I think scientifically we can say, yes, there is, all the equations point to it. I don't think there's any real question about these other dimensions.
Okay,
the real question is, can we interact with these other dimensions?
Well, let me go back to something.
Quantum entanglement, all these are multidimensional concepts.
Okay,
go ahead.
Okay, let me go back to something specifically and concrete you said. And we're basically out of time, so we got to try to finish this up. You basically said you would basically agree with me on this if you said if there was something else besides a mind or something like that. I was thinking, what else is there besides a mind, or if the mind was all there was or something like that?
Yeah, if the mind was all there was, then yes, we would be silicon machines, and would be no difference between a silicon machine and a meat machine, right?
So what else is there?
I'm saying there is a soul. I believe there is a soul, and I think that science is getting as close.
What does a soul have that a mind doesn't have?
Well, there are a lot of things a soul has that the mind doesn't have. A soul is who you are. It is
That's just an identity. It sounds like.
I think it's more than that. It's you can go back to the ancient philosophers, you know. But a soul is who you are. In other words, when your body, let's say your mind, gets diseased or old or something, you are still you. You are just unable to communicate through the. Being given a walkie-talkie or a phone that doesn't work. You're just unable to communicate.
Well, that's what I think doesn't make sense. I mean, when a person has Alzheimer's, they go like, "Well, that's not the real him. The real him is he's gonna get the real him back in heaven when he dies or something." But it's like, no, that is the real you. When you have Alzheimer's, that's really you at that point. And when you were a toddler, that was you at that point. If you die as a toddler, there's no such thing as a real you.
Yeah, the toddler is different because the toddler is growing, so that mind, that soul has not matured. The soul has not grown. It has not. I mean, these are physical aspects that the soul has.
But there's no difference between a toddler that never had a soul and a person who's totally senile, doesn't know who he is, and he's already experienced life. There's no difference. They basically are points in time of what that person is.
Yeah, and this is where we are lacking in information. But it does not mean. All I'm saying is I'm giving you a plausible explanation. Now, if you're asking me to prove that somebody has a soul, I can't. I mean, we've been trying to do this for ages. But all I'm saying is that science tells us that there are multiple dimensions, and if there are multiple dimensions, it's quite feasible that there is intelligent existence in those dimensions, and if there's intelligent existence in those dimensions, then we've explained the soul. That's as simple as that is.
Okay, so we're out of time on that one. The next question is kind of on the same topic, so we might spill over into that.